Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, briefly stated, this should be an exciting conversation from an exciting individual talking about an exciting architect. We're going to talk a little bit, obviously, then open the floor up to Q&A and get your conversation in and really have a dialogue going about this great work, this great book. I put it over here so you don't have
just
to hold
so
it
I don't
again,
roll it. Thank you, Lee. Okay.
Everything's so so relaxed. Get your questions together and have a good time for the next hour or so. You know, I was wondering as I read the book, and how tough is it to write a book about someone who's still alive, particularly one that's as personal as,
right.
as this one?
Right. Well, it was tough in some ways. Actually, not in the way you might think. You know, the issue of not of tiptoeing around difficult things was not really an issue because I made it clear to Frank Gehry before I agreed to do this book that I had to take it on as an independent writer. He would have no authority or no control or no approval rights over the text. And I said to him, if you aren't comfortable with that, I would understand, you know, most people wouldn't be, actually.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
But if so, I will find another book to do. I will not write this book. And he agreed, and we actually had a written agreement that was signed, in which he promised to give me access to him and his staff and his records and archives and all that, and agreed he had no approval whatsoever, no editorial control over the text. So more or less solved that issue that way. The problem I hadn't anticipated about writing about a living person, writing a biography, is that if you think about biographies, you know, they generally end with the death of the subject.
Right.
And so you have a living subject, you know, where does the story stop? And how do you structure the story? And how do you give it a kind of arc that makes sense? That was actually harder to think about and work my way through.
And how do you resolve that? Although if you buy the book, you'll see how
right,
you resolve
right,
it very
right,
well. But
right.
generally speaking, how do you
well,
do that?
You know, it's really interesting. Actually, before we talk about architecture, just to talk about biography because
sure.
it was new to me. I've spent my life writing about people's work. I'd never written about someone's life before, and you know, this book is as much about his grandmother and his therapist as it is about his buildings, and so. Learning how to do all that was an interesting challenge for me. I thought, it's easy to organize a biography because, you know, you start at the beginning and you keep going, and everyone's life, you tell someone's life story in a chronological way. Well, the answer is like kind of, sort of, but not really.
Yeah.
Because if you tell someone's life in an absolutely chronological way, faithful to their calendar, let's say their diary, well, everybody's life is so many different things intertwined at once. You know, how do you really tell the story of a marriage? How do you really tell the story of establishing a practice? How do you really tell the story of a big project like Walt Disney Concert Hall in Los Angeles that took 16 years and was an arc with a million other things going on? So explaining all that in a coherent way that is still faithful to the truth. I mean, in some ways, you know, it's structuring it is almost like writing a novel or a screenplay, except with the added problem of you can't make it up. It has to actually be true and faithful. So that was, for me, the biggest challenge, but also the greatest excitement, because it was why this book represented for me a kind of frontier or an adventure of something new I hadn't done before.
And we'll get to his life and work in a second, but just one more sort of restraining thing, perhaps, or a thing that makes it interesting, is that this is someone that you've known for years. This isn't like you're just Mr. Gehry kind of writing
right,
a book about
right. him. Right, I've known him for years. I met him in the 70s when I was a very, very, very young writer.
And you mentioned in the book. Talk about that. This is a good place to start.
You're
at an event.
We're at an event. It was the American Institute of Architects convention, which that year was in Washington, D.C. And I was really at the very beginning of my career, and I wouldn't normally go to those things, but it was a good place to meet people and maybe get some story ideas or whatever. And this was the 70s when people weren't building as much because there wasn't as much money. And it was there was a reception that was kind of outside, and I was talking to Ada Louise Huxtable, mm-hmm. my colleague at the New York Times, and this man recognizes her, not me, of course, and comes over to say hello. And it was Frank Gehry. And he looked like he didn't quite fit in. Because, you know, in those days, an architect's convention, it looked like an insurance salesman's convention. Right, you know, right. I mean, everybody wore suits and ties. Yeah. And right, oh, really boring. Anyway, and he looked like he didn't entirely fit in. And he was also really interested in what we did and wanted to talk about, you know, journalism. And mm-hmm. and he said, at that point, he had not had a building published in any national publication. He had had a brief period of attention for designing a line of furniture made of cardboard that was called Easy Edges mm-hmm. that was very briefly very hot. In a couple of years earlier, and in fact, Bloomingdale's carried it, and it was written about in design magazines and shelter magazines, mm-hmm. and then it all went like this because he freaked out and pulled the plug and ran away from it, which is I discovered later was sort of a pattern in his life
sure.
of actually suddenly turning his back and walking away mm-hmm. from things or projects or sometimes people mm-hmm. who had been very important and had a lot of potential. And anyway, but that was, so that he said, you know, we might recognize him from that, but, you know, and we started talking, and he was just kind of interesting, and I was also very interested in Los Angeles at that point. Mm-hmm. That was the days when Rainer Banham had just written his book, and the whole idea that Los Angeles might not be this vast wasteland that Woody Allen and people like that in New York all said it was, but a sort of weirdly interesting place if you took it on its own terms. That was what we were all kind of just beginning to think about. And so we talked about that, I remember. And then at the end of the conversation, he just said, oh, if you're ever out there, give me a call. And I was at some point, I don't know, a few months later, and he took me to see a house he'd just finished for Ron Davis, the painter in Malibu. Mm-hmm. And it was this crazy trapezoidal form with corrugated metal, it's in the book, and I was fascinated by it, and in fact, didn't entirely know what to make of it, but in those days, I was writing a lot for the New York Times Sunday Magazine, which shows how long ago this was. They every Sunday, they would publish a residential project. It was great. Boy, do I miss those days. But anyway, I got them to let us do that house mm-hmm. there, and it was the first time one of his buildings had actually been published in a national publication. Hmm. So we go back a long way, and I, as his work went on and his career went on, he was doing more and more interesting stuff, and I had many other occasions to write about it, and we did come to know each other. I felt very strongly when this book project was proposed by the publisher that you know, I established enough distance
sure.
so that I could, you know, I even though we had known each other for many, many years, I actually said to him, look, you know, this only is going to make sense for me if it's going to have some things in it when it's finished that you're not going to like. And I just have to, you know, we just have to be honest about this.
He hasn't told you what he doesn't like, but you said that you suspect there's some things that
I know there's some things he doesn't like. He's told some other people.
Right.
And that's fine, because I'll tell you, if he loved every word of it, mm-hmm. then I would have not done my job. I would have done a terrible, you know. I mean, it's mostly positive. Mm. And I think he knew and trusted that over the years I'd written enough about his work and talked to him enough so he knew that I was basically a supporter of it. Which I am, but you know, it's the stuff he doesn't like is mostly personal.
Mm-hmm. Give us an example without spoiling.
Well, he had a very unhappy first marriage. Mm-hmm. Did not treat either his wife or his children mm-hmm. from that marriage very well, and was. To his credit, you know, candid in discussing all this with me, and I also discussed it with many other people as well. And you know, he said all along, you know, I want the full story of my life told warts and all, everything. It's one thing to say that. It's quite another thing when you actually see it in black and white in front of you. And you think, oh my God, I told him we could say that. Mm-hmm. You know, but the one thing that I do want to say, because it's really important and I admire him for this, our written agreement that I referred to earlier said that he could not make any editorial changes whatsoever, but that he did have the right to read the book once before publication for fact-checking only. And it was interesting that he came up with a few minor things.
How does that work?
Like, you know, some names and dates that were... And we changed all those things. Mm-hmm. He really was... He honored our agreement completely, never said a word about the business about his marriage, his children, his... firing people. He he did say one thing to me at one point, which was very Frank Gehry, because he said, gosh, reading your book, I guess I have a bigger ego than I think I do. He said. And so, there you are.
And we're going to get to that very issue in a few minutes, but let's go back to the beginning a little bit. He's born not Frank Gehry, but he's born Frank Goldberg.
Born Frank Goldberg was his name. Born from a working class Jewish family in Toronto. Mm-hmm. In fact, actually, he said to me at one point early on in this project, he says, I have a perfect title for your book. You can call it Goldberger on Goldberg. the publisher didn't agree title. Yeah. Yeah, and he grew up in a working-class family, very little money, a father who was particularly unsuccessful at many different careers. In fact, it reminds me, I think it was Alfred Kazin or somebody who, in a memoir, said, the only thing my father ever succeeded at was failure. You know, his father had many unsuccessful careers. He was especially close to his grandmother and grandfather. Mm-hmm. His grandfather owned a hardware store, and he would often be sent as a young kid to take care of it or help her out and so forth, and he was fascinated by all the stuff in it. It was actually a hard upbringing in many ways, especially since at one key point when he was about 9 or 10, his father got a job... basically running a route of selling and servicing slot machines in Timmins, Ontario, way up near Hudson Bay, 4 hours north of Toronto. Mm-hmm. You think Toronto's far away, try Timmins. And so he grew up in this one chunk of his life in this totally far away place that was nothing, and experienced significant anti-Semitism, but also fell in love with hockey. So there's compensations, I guess. And then returned to Toronto and so forth.
And so the arc of his life at this point is New York to Toronto, right?
Born in Toronto.
Then New York. No,
never lived in... This is sort of an interesting kind of a very, very marginal thing. He absolutely insists that for 1 year of his very, very early childhood, when he was an infant, his family lived on Avenue J or something in Brooklyn, that there was some business reason that his family relocated there and then returned to Toronto. Nobody remembers what that could have been. There is no evidence to document it. His sister, who was a very helpful source for this book, was not yet born, so she knew nothing about this, but confirmed that her parents would mention it from time to time. So I referred to that just as something that he recalls, but without stating as absolute fact. Exactly. But for all intents and purposes, it was Toronto and then the little mining town in northern Canada and then back to Toronto and then Los Angeles.
Right. Talk about the move to Los Angeles.
Move to Los Angeles, his father was directly connected with. Because his father not only, sadly, had little business success, he also had very, very poor health and was, at one point, had a heart attack. But actually, the heart attack, there was a lot of drama connected to the heart attack because he and his father had a fight and he had the first and only time he'd ever actually physically, sort of, it was not a, nothing, but he sort of shoved his father or something, and not, his father fell over, and then had a heart attack. Frank felt enormous guilt about this, but his health was so marginal. Mm-hmm. He was told by the doctors he could not manage another Canadian winter. And they had some cousins who had recently moved to LA, and so that was just a place, so they went there. If the cousins had moved to Miami, the history of architecture might have been different. Who knows? Yeah. Because they only went there because there was a semi-familiar anchor that they could begin their lives knowing somebody there. But that's it.
How did LA begin to change and shape his life even? Because he's still pretty young when
he was 18. He was 18. Mm-hmm. He graduated from high school. In fact, his family went ahead. Mm-hmm. They left him there with his grandmother to finish high school. Mm-hmm. And then he took the train across country. He had never been out of Canada other than this imaginary year in Brooklyn when he was two, so what did it matter? Mm-hmm. It was quite life-changing, actually. Mm-hmm. In fact, I say in the book that, you know, he left Toronto, this sort of old, very magnificent in some ways, mm-hmm. and wonderful, but old city, and this huge train ride across country, and then emerged out of the train. Interestingly, in both places were called Union Station, but they could not have been more different, and mm-hmm. this Spanish colonial fantasy of Los Angeles, and it was June, and there was sunshine and warmth. And I say in the book, you know, he had been in Kansas and this was Oz. I mean, suddenly it was a whole new world entirely to him. But it was also a world, a very rough world in many ways, because his father had gone on ahead and found them a little apartment, but it was a mean little rental apartment near downtown LA, less comfortable than the house that they had left in Toronto. Mm-hmm. His father got a job driving a root beer truck, and Frank, that was sort of the mm-hmm. where they were in that sphere of life, let's say. And Frank drove a truck also, worked part time, then started taking courses at LA City Community College, mm-hmm. and then the cousin, or the son of the cousins, whatever, was at USC, and he started hanging out with him, which in turn led to a couple of courses at USC, and he started taking ceramics. And he was very interested in it, and he had a very, very gifted ceramics teacher who liked him hugely, but also thought he had no talent for ceramics, and was himself fascinated by architecture and had recently built a modern house in LA by Rafael Soriano, who mm-hmm. was an important modernist in the 40s and 50s in LA. And he brought Frank to the house once and introduced him to the architect, and apparently saw there was such excitement, he said, you should take a couple of architecture courses. Mm-hmm. And there we are. But in fact, it is not as though he was one of those kids who played drawing buildings when he was 4 years old and said, I'm going to be an architect. It almost kind of slipped into it.
And then there's a pivotal moment where he goes to an Alvar Aalto lecture.
That was actually still in Toronto.
Still in Toronto.
That was mm-hmm. the only kind of introduction to architecture he'd had. And it was kind of a brief moment where the clouds parted and the sun came through, but then it covered up again. Mm-hmm. He used to go to lectures in Toronto a lot. He was an intellectually curious kid in many ways, and even though he had a lot of rough edges and came from a working class family, he was interested in a lot of stuff. And he went to this lecture. He'd never heard of Alvar Aalto, but Alvar Aalto was coming to Toronto. I think it was just Friday nights, he would go to these lectures. Mm-hmm. And
pick up and girls, he was, maybe? You know?
Yeah, you never know, exactly. And he was fascinated by it. And he really liked Aalto's work. He mm-hmm. later said that maybe those years in northern Canada and made him respond to the Alvar Aalto was, of course, a great Finnish modernist, respond to Finland in some way, whatever. He really liked it. And the next day, he went to the high school guidance counselor's office and looked up some information about architecture programs. And all he could find was something about the university there, and they had nothing but pictures of sort of old-fashioned English country cottages that looked nothing like what he'd been excited by on the screen during this talk. And he thought, oh my God, if that's architecture, I don't want it. Mm-hmm. And that was the end of architecture until it was reawakened with probably four years later or something, and with the ceramics teacher.
You know, one of the many interesting things about this book, but one of them is that if one wants to, and I wanted to, it seems like as you read through it, you can see Frank Gehry not building himself, but almost being constructed. There's a moment here that you think, that seems like that's one that took. And one of those moments was the time with his grandmother on the kitchen floor.
Yes. This is when he played with his grandmother on the kitchen floor. We're now going back in time. It was not when he was 18 in college.
Exactly. Right.
Yeah. But he adored his grandmother and said that she was the person who saw that he had imagination. Hmm. His father, you know, dismissed him as a dreamer and said he would never amount to anything, which of course really was the father projecting his own sense of failure onto his son. The mother, by the way, took him to his first art museum and to concerts, and she did have a certain kind of cultural ambition, but he connected more easily to his grandmother. And she would play with old, I don't think they could afford, or maybe they just didn't have, you know, blocks and things, but they would play with random scraps of wood and make little toy cities playing on the floor of her kitchen. And that is something he remembers very, very vividly, you know, literally 80 years later, eight decades later, he can still recall that.
Does he make the connection between that and the work he would later do later?
I think he's too smart to think it's a simple, direct connection. His work is not trying to imitate those little things playing with scraps of wood on the floor, even though, in fact, yeah, there are some things that could connect. What it may have helped him do is see a kind of unexpected beauty in ordinary things, especially ordinary things arranged and juxtaposed in unusual ways, which is very characteristic of his work. Although a little bit later, once he really got into things in Los Angeles, he became very, very close to the artist community there, and they probably had a much more direct influence on him than his grandmother, but his grandmother, no question. I mean, just supporting imagination as opposed to being put down for imagination as his father tended to do, that was, I think, the lasting legacy of his grandmother more than the specific things they might have made.
Now, obviously, we're in Chicago. We know the work that he's going to later do here.
Right.
But he visited the city early on with his father.
Yes.
Talk a bit about that and what impression.
That was actually, he said it was the only truly happy time he had with his father growing up. Back when his father's business was slot machines, which, by the way, at one point were declared illegal in Canada, at which point that was the end of his father's business. So it was a failure, I guess, caused by external forces, not his father's own. But when that business was legal, there was some company in Chicago that either manufactured them or was the national distributor or something. I don't remember quite the particulars. But his father had to go there for a couple of days and brought Frank along. And they drove together from Toronto to Chicago and back, stayed at a YMCA. I think they saw a baseball game or something like that. I mean, it was a sort of happy father and son trip of a very conventional sort, but notable more for the absence of that at any other time in his life. And so, than for anything extraordinary about that trip. It was more that his father generally was unable or unwilling to do that often, except he did that one time. And again, you know, we're talking about, you know, almost 80 years later, he still remembers it and smiles. He is, it's interesting, you know, you when you write a biography like this, you don't want to be too obviously Freudian and psychological, and yet on the other hand, you can't not, to some extent, deal with that. And I was so struck by the extent to which a desire to have a better relationship with his father still is this unresolved thing in him all these years later. And in fact, it's 50 years since his father's death. I mean, his father, you know, Frank is 86. His father died when Frank was 36. So
It's a very touching part of the book. He recounts at one point how his father called him stupid. I mean, it really is a
Yes, right, sad. Right. His father calling him stupid and saying he's just a dreamer. He had a newspaper route when they were in that small town of Timmins, Ontario. And his father could sometimes be very cruel. I mean, if Frank didn't sell all the newspapers one day, he would say, oh, that's, you know, you're so stupid, you can't even do that. You know, I bet your sister could do that. And his sister at that point was like five or four or five or something. And he once took Frank and his sister into a bar and in the center of town with the newspapers and told the little girl to hold the newspapers and then said, you know, anybody want to buy a newspaper? And of course, everybody, this cute little five-year-old girl, they said, of course, and they would give her a nickel and buy a newspaper. And his father would say to him, well, you see, your sister can do it. Why can't you? I mean, things that really are kind of cruel when you think about it in retrospect, you know, look back at it. And that scarred him all these years later, still feeling it.
Still there, still there. Well, let's skip ahead a bit.
Sure.
He's on the road, metaphorically speaking at least, of architecture. Tell us about his first sort of gig at a major firm.
Well, he worked for Gruen, a big
Victor
firm.
Gruen.
Victor Gruen, big firm that was actually became prominent for doing shopping centers back before they were bad things. You know, they kind of almost invented the covered mall.
And let's just back up a bit, just to nest a little bit there. Again, I mean, Victor Gruen was a bit of a visionary from Vienna, as I recall, right?
Born in Vienna. Right,
and saw the sort of shops and plazas there and how they related to each other in the street and thought that maybe they could be recreated.
Exactly. That's exactly right. He thought, you know, the mall was started with good intentions, which was to create a kind of, you know, version of the village for the automobile age. And Gruen, you know, later kind of disowned it all and recognized that the progeny of his idea was mostly horrible and said, I will not pay alimony to my bastard children, he said, actually. I think that might be a strange metaphor, but anyway. So
I think Randhurst Mall here is still around as one of his creations.
Right. And famous one in outside of Minneapolis is one of the very first. And anyway, Gehry worked on a couple of those projects in the 50s, including something for downtown Rochester, New York, that he believed, they all believed, was actually going to revitalize the city. And not done. It's amazing how little was understood about the importance of the street in those days, actually. That in fact, you know, if you kill the street, doesn't matter whether the buildings are good or bad, you kill the urbanism. That really wasn't, they didn't get that in the 50s. I mean, I think it took a long time to figure it out, and even Frank Gehry didn't get what he was doing in that early work at all. That it was also kind of wrongheaded. But he did work for, he worked for Gruen in summers in architecture school, and then he went to work right after architecture school. Then he was drafted into the army.
That's right. Spec four, spec three in the Army, right?
I mean, yeah. And he, that was a whole other story. Yeah. And by then he was married and had his first child. Mm-hmm. I think we're now into the sort of mid-50s.
That's right.
And then after the Army, he decided to go to Harvard and get a master's in city planning because he was so interested in the whole question of the future of the city. And that turned out to be a disaster because he didn't understand that the Harvard city planning program was really more sociologically based and more about statistics and stuff like that and demographics and not particularly about design. And so it was a big mess and he never got the degree. And then went back and worked for Gruen again in LA. And then another very formative time was he quit Gruen and took his wife and by then two small children to Paris.
To Paris, that's right. Mm-hmm.
And they lived in Paris for a year. And that opened up the world to him in a whole other way. He'd never been to Europe. Not only had he never been to Europe, he said his architectural education at USC was so focused on what was going on here, or to a certain extent Japan and Asian, that there was almost no study of anything in Europe, either contemporary or historical.
And then when he sees what's there, he's almost upset that he hasn't been...
Yes, yes, he was, exactly.
He
actually was kind of angry that he hadn't learned about all this stuff. I mean, you know, Chartres Cathedral and Romanesque cathedrals he was particularly moved by. I think he liked that combination of grace and brawny, heavy power. And the idea that a heavy structure could also be graceful was something he hadn't seen any evidence of. And suddenly, there's all this amazing stuff in Europe, as well as new work by Le Corbusier and others. And it was, yes, it was kind of life-changing.
Well, at the risk of being Freudian architecture critics again, do you see a relationship, or does he see a relationship between what he saw there and what he would later do?
Yes, actually. There he kind of does. Not, again, a direct relationship, but the ideas, he kind of absorbed the ideas and brought them out in his own way. I mean, there's very little in his work that mimics anything directly, but but he absorbed and absolutely very, very important. And in fact, one of the reasons to jump way to the end of this story, the building that opened a year ago in Paris, the Fondation Louis Vuitton, which actually the opening of it was, is kind of the conclusion of the book. That's how I solved the problem of how to end the book. But because I was very, very, very lucky. There was this spectacular building that opened with a spectacular series of events, including the president of France and giving him medals and all that. So it made a perfect kind of clue. But it also, there was a sense almost that he was repaying his debt to France building this building. And there are ideas that you see from some of the very early things he saw in France that come out in very different form in this building just a year ago,
Now, jumping ahead a little bit, when does, tell the story about how Frank Gehry, the name and the persona, maybe the persona, but certainly the name, changes from Goldberg to Gehry. And there's almost a typographic reason why.
There is. It's a great story. Well, it was his first wife, then, who was herself Jewish, but did not like having a Jewish name. Her name was Snyder. Probably once it was Schneider or something like that, but it became Snyder. And she wanted a more neutral name. And at that point in the early 50s, there was a famous radio show or maybe TV show called The Goldbergs, which was sort of a caricature almost being Jewish. And that made her, that offended her in particular. And she kept pushing him to change the name. And she kind of wore him down. He didn't really want to. And she convinced him largely on the argument that in the early 50s, Los Angeles in particular, in those days, was a very conservative city. And there was a fair amount of anti-Semitism. And she said, you know, you'll get a lot more jobs as an architect if your name is not Goldberg, she said. And he finally shrugged his shoulders and said, okay, but said the one condition he would make is he did not want to change his initials. So it had to be a G. So they start looking around for kind of neutral-sounding name beginning with G. And I don't know whether they had recently been to San Francisco or whether there was some other reason, but they came up with Gehry from Gehry Street, G-E-A-R-Y. And he looked at that, and then he looked at his name, Goldberg, and noticed the profile of Goldberg starts with the capital, down, goes up in the middle, and down, and then ends down. And he said, you know, we could replicate that if we just change it a little bit. And he took out the A from Gehry and put in an H. And so it would, so it was kind of graphic design almost,
yeah, exactly,
of a name. And that's really where Gehry comes from. It was a made-up version of Gehry so that it looked graphically more like what he wanted. And I guess he then felt a little more ownership, creative ownership over the name somehow.
But with this transformation of name, I mean, he doesn't become like all of a sudden...
No.
Archibald Leach becoming Cary Grant. I
mean, no, he absolutely did not. In fact, he was still so ambivalent about what he had done and the fact that he had given into his wife that for a while he would introduce himself, hi, I'm Frank Gehry, I used to be Goldberg. And so it was not an immediate total transformation in any way.
We're going to go to questions from the audience pretty soon, and this book is so great. I guess
why don't I run into you all the time?
I know.
Thank
see,
you.
We see each other every 3 years, and we got to push that time together a little
bit.
I think. So, talk about. Let's go a bit further in his career.
I mean,
he begins to pick up steam.
Right.
One building that's kind of interest to me, and there's images of it in the book, is that he designs the apartment in a sort of apartment complex. The name I forget it. Just now, but it's sort of in this traditional-looking neighborhood, and he builds one that, on first blush, it looks like it's so contextual that it matches the architecture around it. But then, when you look closer, and you look closer, you find that there's really some radical things happening there.
Right.
That's happening.
It was a Hillcrest or something like that in Santa Monica.
Mm-hmm.
It's still there. It's like a six-unit small apartment building. The radical things are very subtle. What you see is actually a guy who can't bring himself to do it exactly straight. You've got to keep pushing something original into everything and a little bit different. And you can also see there was a lot of Japanese influence there in some of the way, because it's a building of wood and stucco. Greg Walsh, who was his good friend and first partner, who he'd met at USC, I'm sure played a significant role in that, as he did in a lot of the other early work. And it's sort of a lovely little project, but you have to look hard to find the Frank Gehry in it. I mean, it really is more like some of that really, really early Frank Lloyd Wright here, where, you know, it almost isn't, unless you really look hard. But you can see something in there just bursting to break through that really did in later work, but didn't quite yet.
When does it happen? When does the Paul to Saul, Saul to Paul come?
The real breakthrough. I mean, it really took, I think, until the 70s. The Ron Davis house that I mentioned before, where he was so interested in issues of perspective and abstraction and wanted to see how could you solve architectural problems that way, and very interested in raw, unfinished things. And that began to creep into his work then. A lot of things where 2x4 frames were visible, not covered. You know, he made a wonderful observation at one point. He said, you know, when he was in LA, as it was developing so fast in the 50s and 60s, and those were the days before there was so much traffic, and it seemed to feel like it all symbolized mobility and freedom, not being stuck on the interstate for 6 hours. So And there were also all these new tract house developments. Mm-hmm. And he said, you know, they when they were starting to go up and you saw just all the frames of these houses, these wooden balloon frames, they all looked so beautiful. Hmm. And then, of course, they got covered up and finished and they looked horrible. So he actually took the idea of that 2x4 frame and tried to put it into some work. And some of the houses in the 70s, where it really came together, where it really began to change everything, and he became somebody that you had to notice, was his own house, mm-hmm. which was 1978 in Santa Monica.
And he's almost 50 at this point. I mean,
he was almost 50, yeah. But you know, architects,
which isn't terribly old. I am 50.
Architects' careers develop slowly. You know, they have a long arc. They're mm-hmm. not like baseball players, or rock musicians, or what have you. So it's not that unusual mm-hmm. for an architect not to sort of hit the big time till 50, and so that house really got everyone talking, and it also resulted in a huge change in his life, too, because one thing we haven't talked about is that in the years up to that point, basically through the 70s, he's doing a lot of work for the Rouse Company, a big real estate developer, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Which was kind of what paid the bills, the bread and butter in his office. He wasn't actually, other than one, he didn't actually do shopping malls. We did other things. Mm-hmm. He built their headquarters in Maryland. He built a bunch of other things. They really liked him and wanted him to come work full-time for them. He said no. Mm-hmm. He wanted to keep his own practice, but nevertheless, he did do the work. And then he finally did one shopping mall for them as well in Santa Monica, his hometown. And when it was finished, was shortly after he'd finished his house. Mm-hmm. And he had the president of the Rouse Company over for dinner after the opening. And the guy walked around and looked at the house, which is an extraordinary but very unusual house, and said, "Frank, you really like this, right?" And he said, "Yes." He said, "You really like doing this stuff more than you like doing that stuff." And he kind of pointed mm-hmm. toward the shopping mall, which was a mile or so away. And Frank nodded. And he said, "Then why don't you just do that?" Hmm. And that was sort of maybe the Saul to Paul moment or something, because that was a Friday night. He spent the weekend agonizing over it. Hmm. And he went in Monday morning and let go half of his office.
Wow.
And said, "I'm only going to do the projects that I think represent a real intellectual or aesthetic challenge for me, mm-hmm. and not do bread and butter work just to pay the bills where I can't have some impact." And the rest is history, I guess you could say. You know,
let me go to the. There's a young lady walking around with a microphone. If you have any questions, put your hands up and she'll get
great
to you. We got one right away there. All right, excellent.
I'm wondering, is there a community or a city or area that doesn't have a Gehry right now that you think would greatly benefit or be impacted by one more than a specific other community, and how?
You know, it's an interesting question. I mean, there are. Frank Gehry now has a pretty substantial oeuvre of work, and there are a lot of them all over. I mean, I think he's a wonderful architect and that his work would impact positively on a lot of communities. But I think your question, I'm going to take your question in a slightly different way, because I think it's a really great way of getting to what has become known as the Bilbao effect. Mm-hmm. You know, because, of course, Bilbao, the Guggenheim in Bilbao, which was the most famous building in the world for a while and the most acclaimed, deservedly so, I think, and which played such a role in transforming this rather rundown industrial city in Spain into an international tourist destination. It's not so easy as it looks. That is not only a great building, it had the effect it did because of a whole series of different things that just happened to have coincided by a combination of luck and planning. You could say, if you believed in astrology, which I don't, but you could say the stars were in alignment in a particular way, because the city had actually already been investing in a lot of other things, a new airport, Norman Foster had designed a new subway system for them, there were other buildings and so forth. It was also the Guggenheim Museum as an institution was very ambitious, was given extraordinary freedom as well as a budget by the regional government of the Basque area of Spain, which really wanted to make an international impact. And Frank Gehry was himself at a moment in his career where he was ready to do a kind of mature building that went beyond anything he had done before. And finally, the technology was, you know, that was a building that was enabled by digital technology and which his firm has been a leader in. And that was just at a point where now the technology was catching up with his imagination, we might say. Mm-hmm. All those things came together at Bilbao. You can't, you know, recreate all that because the architecture, while it is critical and essential, is only the central ingredient in a much more complicated sort of recipe, and it can't automatically be recreated. There was this fallacy after Bilbao
exactly.
that, you know, you get a famous architect to do a wowie building and all your problems go away. Well, no, it was never that simple, and it never will be that simple. So, you know, there we are.
You know, tell us about the work he would do here with the Banishchill. He has a relationship with the Pritzker family.
Yes.
He would later win the award, the Pritzker Award.
He'd run the Pritzker Prize before.
He sure did.
He had become quite friendly with the Pritzkers, which does not, neither the Pritzkers nor the honorees necessarily seek that. And I think he is sort of unusual in that he became a personal friend of the Pritzker family after winning the award. Which, on the other hand, he is a very unusual combination of sort of gemütlicht, likable, affable person and artist with a driven ambition. And, you know, and for whatever reason, he and the Pritzkers kind of clicked and they saw each other a lot and became very friendly. When Millennium Park was being planned, Cindy Pritzker was distressed that the plans seemed rather more conservative and timid than she would have liked. And at one point, in fact, she famously said, "What millennium is this for? Yeah, the last one or the next one?" Yeah. And, you know, we need something that is, you know, going to be more exciting here and really make this place notable. And we need something like Frank Gehry. And she was hesitant. For whatever reason, I think she didn't want to twist his arm to ask herself. Also, at that point, it was really a city project. The Pritzker family had not put its name on it yet. And so a delegation went from the city to meet with Frank and ask, and he said, "Oh, I don't know, you know, I've got, you know, too many things going on, and it's a band show, I don't know, in Chicago." Anyway, and he did his little I don't know number, and they said, "Oh, but you know, if you can't do this, somebody in Chicago is going to be very upset." And he said, "What do you mean?" And I think they like said, you know, initials are CP or something like that, whatever. And he said, "Okay," and agreed. And then the Pritzker family became very engaged with it. Put up a lot of the money, and then it was right around that time that Jay Pritzker died.
That's right.
And it became a memorial to him, basically, at which point Frank, who really had loved Jay Pritzker, put his heart and soul into it, and any thought that he might have not wanted to do it evaporated completely.
What's been the impact, do you think, as a New Yorker looking in, what's been the impact of that project and the bridge, which I tend to forget about, the little bridge that is part of it, exactly.
I think it's been very, very positive. I think Millennium Park in general has had a very positive impact. I mean, it's been, it's a, you know, a new paradigm for the urban park in which, you know, it's about activity more than rural escape or the illusion of rural escape. And I think it's especially important for Chicago, where, you know, I mean, the Chicago lakefront as public space is one of the most extraordinary things of any city in the world, let alone any city in America. But it is a particular kind of public space, and there is not a park that almost feels like it's about urban density more than about connecting to nature.
Sure.
And this park became a model for that. I mean, you know, with the sculptures and all the other elements of it. And now, of course, there's the Renzo Piano Bridge as well. No, I think it's been great. And he's, you know, very proud of it, in fact. And so,
We've got about 5 minutes left. I'm looking for other questions. Okay, here we go.
Hello.
Sorry, I didn't see you there.
So I wonder if you could talk a little bit about Frank Gehry's relationship to Richard Serra and the influence of Richard Serra on his work.
Okay.
Frank Did you Gehry's guys hear that?
Relationship to Richard Serra and the influence of Richard Serra on his work. It's interesting. This is the second time in 4 days someone's asked me that question from the audience. Richard Serra and Frank Gehry were very close for a long time. And there was a huge degree of interest in each other's work. And I think they both influenced the other. You know, Richard Serra is surely a sculptor with an unusually architectonic sense, and many of his buildings, in fact, are, I think, you know, profound spatially. That's a Freudian slip right there. Many of his sculptures are as if they were buildings. Frank Gehry, of course, is among the most sculptural of architects. Serra began to get more and more unhappy about the fact that there was a certain amount of intersection or congruency in their work, and began to make remarks, including one famous interview on Charlie Rose, about Frank Gehry thinking he's an artist, and in fact, you know, if it needs toilets and other stuff like that, it's not art, and it's, you know, I don't like all this business. He's not an artist. And initially, Gehry kind of shrugged it off. Ultimately, it led to a break between them, which is very sad because, in fact, they had been very close friends. They visited each other's studios a lot. I think shared ideas in both directions, actually. And then it kind of ended. And it's just sad because I think they are both among the great creative forces of our time, great creative figures of our time. And doesn't mean everybody who's a, you know, every great artist and architect don't have to be friends, but it's sort of sad when any friendship that's been mutually influencing and beneficial ends when it really didn't have to.
Sure.
But there you are, you know.
We have time for one final question. This is the last question.
If you were in charge of choosing the architect for the Obama Presidential Library, who would get the job?
I am going to pass. Maybe there should be another question here. I'm going to pass for a very real reason, which is that the Obama Foundation has actually asked me to be their professional advisor. And I have been working with them. And so I know more than I am allowed to say about where that process is, and it would be highly inappropriate for me to say anything. However, I will only say that I will not pick the architect. The board of the foundation will not pick the architect. The selection will ultimately be made by the president and the first lady. Our job, the board's job, and me as its advisor, is to go through a very long list of architects, narrow it down in stages, and ultimately present the president and first lady with a very small group, possibly as few as three, who they will meet personally and make a decision about. It will be their decision, not ours.
All right, we're going to squeeze in one more, if we can. Wish we could squeeze
I'm interested in the mechanics of how Gehry works. My wife is Australian, and we've had the joy for the last few years to spend Chicago winters in Sydney summers. And at the beginning of this year, the first Gehry building in Australia opened at the University of Technology, and classes weren't on, so they basically opened the building. And I spent several trips wandering around taking pictures and looking at the nuances. And it's a fascinating place with sort of the rolling brick exterior on one side,
right,
and hard glass on the other, and stone and mirrors inside, and tiered wood, and all kinds of intriguing things. And it made me wonder, does he actually do all of those details, or does he have a team that kind of thinks like he does, and they come in and say, Frank, you know, you really ought to do this over here, because how's that work?
Okay, it works. He conceptually does every building and is engaged all the way through, but you know, you cannot produce work at that scale without a team. Mm-hmm. And he famously tweaks. So that he, on a project like Sydney, for example, you know, he came up with a basic idea, and I think out of conversations with the client and thoughts of various other issues, the notion of trying to do this in brick emerged. He also was interested in experimenting with those shapes and forms he works with in brick, because he'd never done it before, and this seemed like the appropriate moment. And then other people in his office develop specific things that he reviews and often will change. He loves to work with models, and in fact, I've seen situations where there will be a model produced of a design at a certain state, and he will gather his team around, look at it, play with it for a while, stare at it, walk around it 100 times, and then say, what if we did this a little this way and move this a little? And some, you know, young person in the office will run back to the model shop and produce another version that has that tweak, and then they'll look at it, and the process will repeat itself. That's how he likes to work. For somebody who has done such advanced work with technology, he sees it entirely as a tool for execution, not as a tool for creation, which he really likes to do both on paper and with these 3D models. So, and some of them go through dozens of iterations. You know, the apartment tower he did in Lower Manhattan, called 8 Spruce Street, there were, when it opened in the rental office, they had a sort of display of like 40 models about this high that were all different versions as he just kept playing with it all around. And there's one story in the book that where one famous, one client, Eli Broad, fired him because he kept working on the house and wouldn't declare it finished. And Broad said, it's good enough. I like this version. I want to build it. And Frank said, no, I'm still working on it. And ultimately, they had to actually sever their agreement. You know, this is maybe a good way to make an important point about him, which is that there are many things you can say about him, but one that cannot accurately be said about him is that he's somebody who just thinks about shapes and then forces them down people's throats. Mm-hmm. In fact, he's actually one of the most flexible architects I've ever seen in terms of response, feedback from clients, so long as you are basically on the same page with him in a general way.
Sure.
I mean, if what you really want is a glass box, you know, you shouldn't have come to him in the first place.
Right, uh-huh.
But if you want a Gehry building, you know, he will work with you through 50 different versions until you're in sync with him about it. He is quite far from a kind of take it or leave it sort of architect, actually. So, you know, that's key to his way of working, is continual tweaking over and over and over again.
Excellent, excellent. And I think maybe that's the last point we may have to leave it with. Again, great book.
Thank you.
Interesting things about technology, parallels to Frank Lloyd Wright, and this great scene setter with Bruce Ratner in New York, which should be in a movie someplace.
So I like
big round
that.
Of applause for Paul Goldberger.
Well, thank you, Lee.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thanks.